So far, we've been interested in strategies of Connect Four, but now it's time to apply those strategies to get a structural understanding of the game. First of all, you're going to have to get comfortable imagining the game as a tree. For a position of our choice, we draw a node. There are some moves that can be made from that position, which we'll represent as connected child nodes. Yellow can play in the left column, the next column over, and so on successively. We connect those new nodes to the root with yellow lines, since yellow was the one who played a move here. And from these positions, there are even more options that can be made, by red this time, continuing the graph. In other words, every path through this graph represents a particular continuation from the existing board. Any set of moves that you could make is in this graph. As a result, it gets intractably large really quickly. At any position in the opening, there are 7 possible moves to make. So at a depth of 0, the amount of nodes is 1, that is, the empty board. At a depth of 1, the amount of nodes is 7, the 7 openings. At a depth of 2, the amount of nodes is 49. And the progression continues exponentially. Now, this is just a mess. You can't tell the structure of this graph whatsoever, and we're only 4 moves in. In fact, it's been computed that there are a total of 4.5 trillion unique positions at any depth. We can do some tricks like deduplicating based on horizontal symmetry, but that'll only remove less than half the nodes, because we're only deleting one node per mirror pair. We're going to need a bit of a paradigm shift if we want to gain any insight from this tangled mess. Instead of growing the graph from the beginning of the game out, let's start with an endgame position to make life a little easier on ourselves. This is a particular endgame. Let's see what it looks like when we expand out its full tree of positions. Now, I want to focus on the nodes of this graph. Let's identify all the terminal states, that is, the nodes which have no children. In other words, we're identifying the games which either red won, yellow won, or completely filled without a winner, making it a tie. In the case of this endgame, there are some paths that lead to a red victory, some paths that lead to a yellow victory, and some paths that lead to the game becoming a tie. So what we might want to know is, who's favored in the root position? If both players play perfectly, who wins? We've constructed this graph, so how can we use it to play optimally from this position? We'll have to work our way up to that point. Consider this board, which is in the graph. The game hasn't ended yet, but it's about to. It's red's move, with only one choice, which is to win the game. So, for all intents and purposes, we might as well color this node red too. Red'll win here. We can repeat this line of thinking for all the other moves which force the game into an ending state. Awesome, but now we're out of obvious nodes to fill in. What about this one? There's more than one choice, but both of the children have already been colored with a computed game result. If we show the edge colors again, we recall that it's yellow to move in this position. Looking at the children, one's yellow's win, and one's a tie. Well, yellow will naturally take the win over a tie. Therefore, we can color this node as yellow. In general, a node's status is the best result of all the children, on behalf of the player whose move it is. The algorithm we just used is called Minimax. We've worked our way all the way back up to the endgame which we considered in the first place, and it turns out that it was a tie. This is called a strong solution. In a strong solution, we examine each possible board and document what the result should be under optimal play. You can think of the strong solution as a dictionary of positions. You can look up a position, and the dictionary tells you who's favored there. If we already have a strong solution, we can use it to play optimally. Let's imagine we're playing as red. Let's say yellow plays in the 7th column. Now it's our turn, so we look at all the children of the current node, and choose the one with the best outcome. In our case here, one child's a tie, and one shows yellow winning. So we'll choose the tied node, corresponding to a move in the 7th column. Yellow responds in the 5th column. We examine the new children here and play in the 5th column in response, which is the child node with the best outcome. Now yellow plays in column 7. In this case, the children have the same outcome, so we can just pick one at random. Now yellow only has one choice, which is to conclude the game as a tie. By doing this, we as red have made the best possible move at each turn, and therefore achieved the optimal result for the starting position. Now, instead of doing the selection of optimal branches while playing the game, we can do it up front all at once. We consider each node for which it's red's turn. For those nodes, we'll examine their edges, and from there, select an optimal child node. We can now delete all other children. It's important to note that this is no longer a strong solution. There are positions which exist, but which are no longer present in our graph. We've now chopped off all the variations which we wouldn't choose to play as red. In the graph, this means that all the nodes for which it's red's turn have only one red edge coming out, namely the optimal one of our selection. But we haven't deleted any of the yellow edges. You'll still notice that some nodes have multiple yellow children. This is because we still need to know how to respond to every possible branch which yellow can concoct. What we've developed here is called a weak solution, on behalf of red. It doesn't contain all positions, but it contains enough for us to guarantee red to play optimally. For that reason, it shouldn't be a surprise that all the nodes which were yellow to win have been removed. That would have required a red blunder to get to, and we've removed all branches which contain red blunders. So the obvious question is, can we apply minimax to the opening to determine who should win from the starting position? In theory, sure, but even with our modern computers, we can't do this for 4 trillion nodes. It's just too much. But by ignoring branches which are suboptimal while traversing the graph in the first place, along with a bunch of other tricks, this becomes doable. Using these strategies, Connect 4 was solved. We know that under optimal play, red wins, and only does so by starting with a disk in the center column. One space off to either side and it's a tie, and anywhere else it's yellow to win. But why? Knowing the game theoretically optimal move at any position is great, but it provides absolutely no insight into why this is the case. Let me make an analogy. Imagine a prisoner is forced to memorize a deck of flashcards. On the front of each card is a two-dimensional coordinate, and the back of each card is a hexadecimal number. The prison guard forgot to mention that the color codes on the back of the cards document the precise color of the Mona Lisa painting at those two coordinates, and sadly, our prisoner was too caught up memorizing numbers to realize the structure underlying the data. You may call that prisoner the world's leading expert on the Mona Lisa, at least in the sense that if somebody held a contest to recreate the painting from memory, he'd win it, pixel by pixel, as long as the prison guard remembers to tell him that's what the data represents. But, until that happens, if you were to go up to him and ask, is Mona Lisa's left hand on top of her right, or is it the other way around, he would have no idea. This analogy sort of illustrates the position we're in with our strong solution for Connect 4. Just because we know these disparate facts about who wins in what scenario, we can't say we truly understand this system any better than before. What's more, this information is effectively incommunicable. Any solution tree is so big that you simply can't be bestowed that information. You can't realistically visualize it, and you can't realistically memorize it. Here, this position's pretty simple. The game's gonna end in two moves, and there's no choices to be made. Naturally, our graph is also extremely simple. Let's delete some disks from the board and see how the graphs grow. Okay, that's already getting a little bit bigger. I'll keep plucking off pieces, and you can watch what happens. All the graphs are just gonna keep growing exponentially, with the strong solution being the biggest, and the weak solution being the smallest. This should give some intuition that even if you claim to have memorized a weak solution tree of the whole game, merely verifying your memorization would likely take a lifetime. So, is there any way to rigorously unite the wisdom and intuition accrued by human experts with the output of this enormous algorithm? Well, strong solution tells us everything that could be known, but weak solutions have a lot more room for creative expression. Take a close look at this particular weak solution. Notice how it has a very regular structure? That's not because all weak solutions are well structured. It's because I handpicked this one with the intention for it to be simple. We can remove even more pieces and get a better view. You know how when your computer is storing files, structured information can easily be compressed and the file size can be decreased? Can we immensely reduce the amount of information required to know a weak solution such that it doesn't require rote memorization? In other words, are there any particularly clever ways of representing such weak solutions? We can represent them graph theoretically, but perhaps they can be expressed by other means. I'll give you a hint, claim even's the magic bullet here. We can use a positional language built on top of the idea of claim even to concisely express solutions to positions which have a high degree of self-symmetry. And in doing so, we can get the full board graph down from the trillions of nodes to the order of the tens of thousands. Or at least, I think so. I still haven't been able to perform this reduction for the entire graph. Still working on that technical challenge. But what I can tell you for sure is that there's some real human openings which, using reduction by claim-even-like strategies, have weak solutions expressible with less than 1,000 nodes. Not even a megabyte. And they're totally visualizable. And if you want to go there, memorizable too. This is a pretty big deal, because it formalizes the player's intuition of discrete variations or openings which are complex and worth learning. The offshooting lines in these graphs map onto them perfectly. I'll spoil this one here, but you'll have to stay tuned to see exactly how we accomplish this, as well as what we can learn about systems other than Connect4 from these compressed solutions. This has been 2Swap.